So hello everyone, a very good evening to all of you. This is Anand Sangre and I'm really happy to welcome you today on this unique live panel discussion on investments and banking sector before and after COVID-19. I have along with me three industry experts, Mr. Sameer Vora, Mr. Shrikant Goyal and Mr. Suryakant Thakkar. Let me give you a quick introduction of all of our three eminent panelists today. Before initiating this session. So I'll start with Sameer first. Sameer is a good friend of mine and he's a founder of Awesome Finvest. Sameer is by profession and by qualification is a chartered financial goal planner, having almost 18 plus years of experience in the stock broking, insurance, debt market and mutual fund industry. And he has won several awards throughout his career, but two most notably awards are one from the Wealth Forum Emerging Advisor of the Year and another one from the CNBC TV18. Sameer advises over 1,100 families and institutions, which comprises of almost 2,500 individuals. And the total assets under management of Ocean Finvest is almost rupees 1,300 crores. I would like to introduce our today's second panelist, Mr. Shrikant Goyal. Shrikant is a managing partner at Finwise Consultants. And Shrikant is an IIM Ahmedabad alumnus and an FRM holder, financial risk management degree. And having completed two levels of global CFA, he has almost 12 years of working experience with the banking sector and has worked as an assistant vice president with Tata Capital in the past. And has also worked as a treasury manager with IDBI. Would like to introduce Mr. Suryakant Thakkar as well, who is the founder and managing partner at SMD Financial Solutions. Suryakant has a degree in engineer and is also an MBA finance, has a widespread experience of almost 25 plus years in raising funds for small and medium sized enterprises, and has a good network across all public, private sector banks and leading NBFCs, with almost 5,000 plus existing customers with a retention ratio of 80% almost. So before initiating today's discussion and today's session, I would like to convey to all of you that we have conducted this panel discussion for a course called Be Hunger Hero. And I'm sure that you would have all noticed in the invite creative as well at the bottom of the invite creative regarding this particular course, wherein Be Hunger Hero initiative has been carried out with a specific purpose that we cannot build a peaceful world on hungry stomach. And it has been a great journey so far. And the platform has almost 100 hunger heroes and have distributed almost 15,000 plus meals so far on the very third day of the initiative. I would strongly recommend to contribute whatever best possible from your side, and will make sure that your contribution will go to the intended beneficiary transparently. You may contribute from the website directly or through its Facebook and Twitter page. Panelists, I have received a couple of requests from few participants that they would like us to conduct this session a bit in Hindi and English, both the languages. So I would request you to kindly take a note of the same. Now, I would like to start today's discussion with one question from my side. And for the same, I would like to launch a poll. That poll will showcase to you the question and the 3-4 answers below it. Would like to request all of you to elect the option which is best suitable according to you, and then we'll initiate this session. So I'll just start with the poll first with one question at the moment. I will also request the panelists also to vote for the same. I'm launching the poll. Maximum 3 to 4 seconds at the max. The question is it the right market level to invest your savings in the Indian stock market, specifically Nifty? Or are you waiting for any of the below market levels to invest a portion of your savings? There are four options. One is at current level, maybe 8,300, index 7,800 or above 10,000. Would request everyone to just participate in this poll. This will give an interesting result at the end. So the panelists, Suryakant, Sameer and Shrikant, 46% of the people have the opinion that they would like to wait. 15% with 83% in 8,300 index and 7,800 with 40%, and just 3% of them would say about 10,000. Okay, interesting. So I'll start today's discussion with some insights on the foreign direct investment scenario within India, wherein I was reading an article wherein it was mentioned that according to the government data, India received 64 billion of FDI during FY 18-19, which was a 6% jump year on year compared to the previous year, which was the third year in a row when global FDI flows was declining. According to the Global Investment Trade Monitor report, India was ranked amongst top 10 as far as the FDI inflow is concerned, as far as year 2019 is concerned. But all this was before this pandemic called COVID-19. We all know that the Indian economy has been experiencing significant slowdown over the past few quarters. Probably we all had witnessed one of the lowest growth in last 6 years at the rate of 4.7%. And government has already taken a lot of stimulus, a lot of measures have been taken to bring back the economy on the growth path. It was seen in the third quarter of financial year 19-20, and there was a strong hope of recovery in the last quarter of the current fiscal. However, this coronavirus epidemic has made the recovery extremely difficult in the near to medium future, and the outbreak has presented fresh challenges for the Indian economy as of now. With these insights, Sameer, my first question to you is that, do you see any positivity in this pandemic for the Indian market?
Thanks, Anand. Good afternoon to all. We have seen lots of medical crises in past, like in 1994, Surat plague, SARS, Ebola, Zika. We have also seen some of the financial crises in 2008, subprime, 2013, taper tantrum. This is the first time we are witnessing financial and medical crisis put together. But as Anand had told, let's discuss on the positive side. So yes, definitely. So first is crude. As we know, India is a crude importing country. Year on year basis, we are importing somewhere 1.5 billion barrel crude. And we used to pay $70 per barrel. Now, crude price went down to 25 barrel. So each dollar reductions that will add 1.5 billion to our accounts. And as headline says, India will save somewhere $45 to $50 billion. The second is trade deficit between India and China. It's somewhere $70 billion. Now things are not fast moving from China to India. Some of the good we will replace through under Make in India program. So I feel that will help to save us somewhere $12 to $14 billion this year. Third, in 1980, India and China both on same level as far as GDP is concerned. Currently, as we know, China is manufacturing hub to the world. Chinese economy is 5 times bigger than the Indian economy. Just because of COVID-19, we have opportunity to gain some of the shares on manufacturing side. Because many of corporates want to exit from China and they are looking for some of the better options either in some of the other countries. जैसे मैं यहाँ पे आप बात करता हूँ कि मोदी जी ने एक छोटा सा मैसेज भेजा था टाटा को सुस्वागतम करके, एंड टाटा प्लान एज वी नो दे सेटल सिंगूर टू साणंद. कैन वी डू द सेम? अगर हम लोग ये कुछ कर पाए तो इंडिया के लिए आने वाले नेक्स्ट 10 to 15 years बहुत अच्छी अपॉर्चुनिटीज रहने वाली है. मैं यहाँ पे एक आपको छोटा सा एग्जाम्पल देना चाहता हूँ. सैमसंग इंडिया में वियतनाम से पहले आया. इंडिया में आके वो मेक इन इंडिया कर रहा है. यहाँ पे वो टीवी, मोबाइल, फ्रिज सारे इलेक्ट्रॉनिक गुड्स बना रहा है एंड सेलिंग टू द इंडिया ऑलरेडी कर रहा है. एंड समवेयर 10 to 12 billion dollars का इंडिया में वो ट्रेड कर रहा है. हमारे बाद वो वियतनाम जाता है. वियतनाम जाके वो मेक इन वियतनाम कर रहा है, सेलिंग टू द वर्ल्ड कर रहा है. एंड वियतनाम इकोनॉमी में वो $70 billion कॉन्ट्रीब्यूट कर रहा है. एज वी नो लास्ट 15 years में वियतनाम इकोनॉमी वन ऑफ द फास्टेस्ट ग्रोइंग इकोनॉमी है. एंड सैमसंग अलोन 28% कंट्रीब्यूट करता है वियतनाम इकोनॉमी को। तो अगर हम ये जो सारी कंपनी वहां से चाइना से शिफ्ट होके कहीं और जाना चाहती है उसमें से सम कंपनीज को हम लोग इंडिया में ला सके, उनको फ्लोरिश कर सके, उनको सपोर्ट कर सके, तो आई फील नेक्स्ट 10-15 ईयर्स इंडिया के लिए बहुत अच्छे होने वाले हैं।
Interesting, Samir. I mean, it looks quite promising, as you rightly mentioned, with couple of facts over here that gives a positive aspects about the current incidents that we should take. So, Shrikant, as Samir, based on Samir's discussion and inputs, there is a hope that Indian economy would definitely bounce back, and there can be a good future going ahead. But considering the current situation, I would like to know that is there any kind of lending that the banks are doing at this time of pandemic?
First of all, good evening, Anand Bhai, and it's my pleasure to be present here on this wonderful platform.
Same here.
When you are talking about products, yes, there are a section of banks which are offering a lot of customers an ad hoc facility. What I mean by ad hoc facility are basically they are offering 10% of their fund-based limit. As you would be aware, there are two kinds of facilities which generally bank offer, fund-based as well as non-fund-based facilities. So right now they are offering as an ad hoc facility to the tune of 10% of the total limit of fund-based. Beyond that, this 10% of this facility can be paid over a period of 2 years. Initial 6 months would be moratorium, and remaining 18 months you can pay in EMIs. Additionally, I would not say they are offering products, but they are definitely offering some kind of solutions, I would say. The first solution which the bankers are offering is right now is they are giving you option to convert your non-fund based facility into fund based facility. As you would agree, it is in normal course of business, bankers do not promote conversion of non-fund based limit to fund based limit, but due to this extraordinary situations, bankers are promoting this product. Second solution which bankers are offering, they are relaxing certain norms for calculating the drawing power. For layman, a drawing power is nothing but a calculation of your drawing eligibility for your working capital limits. So earlier it used to happen that they used to fund 90 days receivables. So now, if you ask, they are also open to consider for 120 to 150 days. Second, for stocks, they are open for 85% to 90%, which is as at present, it is about 75%. So these are some of the solutions which bankers have already offered. But yes, as a borrower, we have to go proactively to them, to banks, and ask for these facilities. Let me remind to all of the borrowers here that these facilities will not come to you directly. Our banker will not gonna call you and ask for these. You need to chase bankers and ask about it. Beyond that, I have a full belief and that as soon as this market get open, maybe we all are expecting second week of May, this will slightly open. We can see that bankers are going to offer supply chain product very aggressively. What I mean by supply chain product, if you are supplying to any of large corporates, so against your bills, bankers are going to fund that. So these are some of the options which presently bankers are offering to borrowers.
Interesting, Shrikant. So assuming that the business would definitely take some time to get out from this current challenging situation, Shrikant, according to you, what borrowing products customers should prefer in this period?
First of all, thank you, Anand Bhai, for having me here. It's a privilege to be part of the webinar.
Thank you.
Now, looking into the current situation, we know that most of the industries will need some kind of liquidity, some kind of buffer to tide the situation. So broadly, we can say there will be two types of products we would suggest. One would be for the existing customers who already, as Shrikant has just said, have already existing limits. So they may go for a temporary overdraft or an ad hoc limit. Also in the existing customers, there will be some who have taken short-term fronts, maybe for 24 or 36 months, and who are having outflow which is on the higher side. So let's take an example. If he has a 1 crore loan for a 36 months tenure, the EMI would be roughly about 3.6 lakhs. But instead of that, I would advise them now to go for a long-term loan. So even if we convert it to 10 years, the EMI would come down to 1.2. So we can see a cash flow saving of about 2.4 lakhs, which would help him to use that cash flow in the running business. So this is what we can, this is the advice you would give to the existing customers. Now, the second part is the new borrowers who in the current situation who are looking for funds. For them, it would be better to go for a temporary overdraft or a drop line limits, and not go for any kind of drawing powers, because that would require a lot of compliances. So the advantage of a DOD or a OD is that the interest will be charged only on utilization, again helping the client save benefit, and the interest is also saved, and there is no fixed liability on his part. So this is what is the broad options we can think of in the current scenario. Thank you.
Okay, Surinam bhai, noted. So I mean, Srikanth, you have worked across Tata Capital with IDBI, and I'm sure with an overall experience of yours in this banking sector, you would be knowing that how these big boys at banking and financial institutions would have would definitely act in scenarios like this. So just wanted to understand that what would be the preferred sector post this pandemic for this banking and financial institutions in terms of the lending?
Anand bhai, I believe the answer to this particular question is very obvious. There are a few sectors.
Pharma and healthcare.
So you said it, yeah. So there are few sectors which I believe hasn't impacted. I would rather say they have been positively impacted due to this pandemic. These sectors are, of course, pharma, as you mentioned. There would be FMCG segment. There would be packaging segment. We can see lot of expansion plan in the packaging sector, which would come. Plus, sanitization services also a type of business which would come in India, and they have a big role there. So these are the certain sectors which definitely bank will run with full bag of cash, and they would definitely be in demand. But what I strongly believe that government gonna push their projects, their infrastructure projects, very, very strongly, because of multiple reasons. One is the job, of course. There is another thing which Samir bhai was telling, that if you want to lure companies who want to exit China, definitely you have to have your infra. So infrastructure companies would definitely have a brighter future, and I can tell you that at least public sector banks will fund infrastructure company in a very aggressive way in near future.
Okay, got the sense. So Samir, as Srikanth and Suryakant bhai has shared the feedback about how banks will operate in this current scenario and post COVID-19 outbreak, I believe that the uncertainty about the future that has been created due to this COVID-19 has also made the financial market extremely volatile, leading to huge crashes and wealth erosion, and which in turn is impacting the consumption levels currently. And everyone present here would have seen the market crash of March 12, when following the trend of global equity market, both BSE and NSE crashed by more than 8% in a single day, where BSE dropped by over 2919 points, and similarly Nifty dropped by almost 868 points. And an estimated 10 lakh crore of market cap was reportedly wiped off during this single day fall. According to you, should we really think about investing in this current market? And if yes, then what are the segments, whether it should be large cap, mid cap, small cap, where exactly according to you?
Anand, agar aap abhi dekho to large cap company shayad aapko 3 saal purane price pe mil rahi hai. If you look mid cap market, it's somewhere quoting 5 to 6 year. And agar aap small cap company dekho to shayad aapko 10 saal purane price pe mil rahi hai. तो मार्केट में कभी कभी ऐसे अपॉर्चुनिटीज आती है, एंड डेफिनेटली आपको उनका इन्वेस्ट करना चाहिए. मोर इम्पोर्टेंट, मार्केट में जब भी आपको इन्वेस्टमेंट्स करना होता है सिर्फ तीन रिक्वायरमेंट होती है आपकी। फर्स्ट, मुझे अच्छा बिजनेस चाहिए, अच्छा मैनेजमेंट चाहिए एंड रिजनेबल प्राइस चाहिए। अगर आप 2 महीने पहले देखो तो आपको अच्छा बिजनेस मिल सकता था, अच्छा मैनेजमेंट मिल सकता था, बट प्राइस बहुत हाई था। नाउ करंटली ऑलमोस्ट 25-30% आपको वही सारे बिजनेसेस डिस्काउंटिंग में मिल रहे हैं, तो आपको यहाँ पे इन्वेस्टमेंट्स करना सोचना चाहिए। सो करंटली माय आंसर इज वेरी मच क्लियर, डोंट लुक लार्ज कैप, मिड कैप, स्मॉल कैप। जैसे अभी श्रीकांत ने बात किया हुआ है, सूर्यकांत भाई ने बात किया हुआ है कि बहुत सारा स्ट्रेस चल रहा है एंड इससे काफ़ी कंपनीज की बैलेंस शीट हिट हो जाएगी। तो अगर आपको इन्वेस्टमेंट्स करना है तो उसी कंपनी में आप इन्वेस्टमेंट्स करिए जहाँ पे डेट नहीं है, लिवरेज नहीं है। सो आप देखिए अभी मार्केट में तो काफ़ी ऐसे आप कंपनीज की आप बैलेंस शीट आपको मिल जाएगी जिसकी कैश रिजर्व उसकी मार्केट कैप से ज़्यादा है, जिसका डेट टू इक्विटी रेशियो माइट बी 0.2-0.3 है, जिसका ईबीटा इज मोर देन देयर मार्केट कैप। तो ये सारी कंपनी में शॉर्ट टर्म में चैलेंजेस डेफिनेटली आने वाली है, बस लॉन्ग टर्म में ये सर्वाइव हो सकती है। आप देखिए आप इन्वेस्टमेंट टाइम पे आप क्या सोचते हो, साइज एंड स्टेबिलिटी, कि अगर बड़ी कंपनी है एंड स्टेबिलिटी है तो मुझे इन्वेस्टमेंट्स करना है। बट एज फार एज इंडिया इज कंसर्न्स, यहाँ पे निम्बलनेस एंड एजिलिटी वो भी बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट है। बिकॉज इंडिया में जो ग्रोथ है वो शायद 25-30 साल का है। कुछ कंपनी ऐसी हो सकती है जो मैंने अभी आपको बात किया, शायद 1-2 साल उसमें थोड़ा बहुत डैमेज हो, बट उसमें रेजिलियंस है, मार्केट में वो कंसोलिडेट खुद को कर पा रही है एंड न्यू एज बिजनेस के साथ खुद को मॉडिफाई कर पा रही है, तो वही विनर होके बाहर निकलेगी। सो डोंट फोकस ऑन स्मॉल, लार्ज एंड मिड। आपको सिर्फ यही देखना है कि 3 महीने 4 महीने जितना भी ये चलने वाला है उसके बाद किसकी बैंक किसके बैलेंस शीट में पैसा पड़ा हुआ है, कौन सर्वाइव हो पाएगा एंड वहां पे आपको इन्वेस्टमेंट्स करना चाहिए।
मेक सेंस, दैट्स अ गुड इनपुट आई वुड से। सो श्रीकांत, रिसेंटली आरबीआई हैज कम आउट विद वेरियस मेजर्स फॉर ईजिंग डाउन दिस स्ट्रेस सिचुएशंस फॉर द कॉर्पोरेट्स एंड बैंक, विद मॉरेटोरियम पीरियड फॉर द कॉर्पोरेट्स फॉर पेइंग देयर ईएमआईज ऑन द लोन एंड डिक्रीज ऑफ रेपो एंड रिवर्स रेपो रेट एंड ऑल दैट स्टफ। Just wanted to understand, is there any extension that has been granted for non-fund facilities like letter of credit, LC, BC or bank guarantee period within this measurements that RBI has taken?
Anand bhai, to give you answer, RBI has not given any kind of extension to any of the non-fund based facility. Whether you can call it letter of credit, bank guarantee, that has to be paid on time. However, there are banks which are offering some kind of facility to pay those non-fund based limits. So you need to approach those banks. I'm sure about public sector banks are offering these kind of products, that if your non-fund based, supposedly your letter of credit is due and that is for about say couple of crores, you need to approach the bank and the banks will give you 2 crores as an additional facility, a fund based facility, and they will credit the same in your account. You're gonna pay that letter of credit and you will get 3 months to pay that additional. And just to remind you that this 2 crore would be over and about 10% of limit, which in the first point I just spoke. So that's how you can pay to your non-fund based facilities. However, we are also expecting government to offer few more packages to various corporates, which are yet to be announced. But right now, I believe if you have any payment due, trust me, as a borrower, you cannot afford to default. So proactively, you can approach to the bank. These are some kind of solutions which bankers are offering right now. You need to talk to them. And all these solutions will depend on bank to bank and your relationship with the bank. If for any reason you have defaulted in past, I'm sure they will not support you in this difficult time. But if your conduct of the account is good, in previous they're going to support you for this non-fund based limits also.
Understood. All the participants, please keep on raising your questions and answers in the Q&A chatbot, and we'll definitely attend to it before ending this particular session. So Srikanth and Srikanth bhai, I was reading an article somewhere where it was mentioned that this continuous slowdown in the economy would definitely have an impact on banks' asset quality, and the quality may trigger the GNPA, that is a gross NPA ratio, from the current level to about 9.6-9.9% by second or third quarter of this new financial year 2021. Just wanted to understand, Suryakant bhai, that whether this is going to affect the lending capacity of the bank and financial institutions in a time to come for next 6 to 12 months or 12 to 18 months?
For this, Anand bhai, let's go back a little in time when Mr. Rajan had started the asset quality review. And once he had started, there was a jump in NPAs and we had peaked at about 11.5%. And then recent last two quarters, it had stabilized. Also, we have seen in the last three, at about 27 nationalized banks in about 2017. And right now we have about 12 after consolidation. So the private banks, in this time, the private banks and the NBFCs captured the market share in lending, and almost it had reached up to 60-70% because of the said issues with public sector banks. So after COVID-19, we will see a lot of funding again coming up by the banks, and their share may increase to about 70%. The reason is, because of the current scenario, private banks will be a little conservative for the next 2-3 quarters. Till there is some clarity and there is some underwriting risk mitigation, they will not fund aggressively. So it will be a push by RBI and the government to the PSB probably to go for aggressive funding.
Got it. So got that it. Should okay. Got your point. So Samir, I have a question for you once again. It's obvious that when the global economy is on a slowdown pace, no emerging economy can grow at a normal pace. And Indian economy was grappling with its own issues and COVID-19 made the matter worse. I believe the last peak that we had seen was of 7.9% during maybe last quarter of financial year 17-18. And now we have witnessed, I mentioned in my previous conversation, of 4.2-4.5% during FY 19-20. The industry was also facing demand problems, due to which many corporates and business houses had to postpone their capex plans. Unemployment was at its peak. Exports were consistently down for several months. And this pandemic has increased the problem of this slowing economy. And hence, going forward, some individual sectors of the economy will take a big hit. So according to you, what are the broad risks associated with the Indian economy, businesses and stock market?
Anand, agar aap macro economy ko dekho, unke char pillar hote hain: consumptions, investments, government expenditures, export versus import. Out of four, do pehle se clean world ho chuke hain. Shayad government expenditures thoda bahut kuch kare, बट इज यू राइटली सेड कि एक्सपोर्ट बहुत हीटेड है एंड शायद नेक्स्ट 4-5 महीने और कुछ होने वाला दिख नहीं रहा है. अभी जो 40 डेज का जो लॉकडाउन चल रहा है उससे काफ़ी बिजनेस की बैलेंस शीट ऑलरेडी स्ट्रेस में आ गई है एंड मुझे लग रहा है कि शायद जॉब लॉस स्टार्ट हो जाएगा इंडिया में. इफ़ यू सी US फिगर्स, वहाँ पर ऑलरेडी 12-15% लोगों ने अनएम्प्लॉयमेंट के लिए फाइल कर दिया है. गवर्नमेंट का भी क्लियर फोकस है ऑन द सोशल स्टिमुलस कि किसी भी तरह लोगों की हम लोग जान बचाए. आर्बिट्रेरियम जो कुछ भी बेनिफिट देना चाहता है वो कर सकता है. जैसे 27 मार्च हमने देखा कि RBI ने अपने लेवल पे क्लोज टू 3.5 लाख करोड़ का लिक्विडिटी मार्केट में रिलीज किया, जो अभी तक का सबसे हाईएस्ट है. इससे पहले हमने कभी नहीं ऐसा देखा. बट ये जो लिक्विडिटी रिलीज किया वो ट्रिपल ए एंड डबल ए रेटेड कंपनी से नीचे नहीं जा रहा था. RBI ने बहुत अग्रेसिवली उसको एड्रेस किया कि 50,000 करोड़ दे हैव कंट्रीब्यूटेड टू NBFC ऑल्सो. सो वहां से क्या हो रहा है कि भाई शायद ये जो सिंगल ए या फिर वो सारी कंपनी से वहां पे थोड़ा बहुत पैसा जाना स्टार्ट हो. दूसरा, जो मॉनिटोरियम दिया हुआ है 90 डेज का, मुझे लग रहा है कि अपने लेवल पे ठीक है बट उससे काम नहीं होने वाला है. आप देखो तो ये जो छोटी कंपनीज है जिसकी बैलेंस शीट ऑलरेडी हिट हो चुकी है, हिट हो रही है, आप 12 महीने का उसके पास कॉस्टिंग मांग रहे हो और उसके पास इनकम शायद 8 या 9 महीने का है, तो उनके लिए आपको लोन को रिस्ट्रक्चरिंग करना बहुत जरूरी है। हमने 10 दिन पहले देखा कि सम ऑफ द स्टेट गवर्नमेंट, मैंने ऑलरेडी यहाँ पे पीपीटी में रखा हुआ है उसको, 99% पे वो फंड बोरो कर रहे हैं मार्केट से। आपका रेपो चल रहा है 4.4 और आपको फंड रेज करना पड़ रहा है 9% स्टेट लेवल पे, तो आप सोचो कि कॉर्पोरेट की हालत आगे जाके क्या होने वाली है। दूसरा, हमारी जो फाइनेंशियल सेक्टर्स है वहाँ पे पहले से ऑलरेडी प्रॉब्लम चल रहे थे। हमने देखे हुए पहले के पीएसयू बैंक के एनपीए के इश्यूज थे, हमने रिसेंटली प्राइवेट सेक्टर बैंक के कुछ कंसर्न इश्यूज देखे जो उसको हल करने की कोशिश की गई, हमने एनबीएफसी साइड पे भी बहुत सारे इश्यूज देखे हुए हैं। अब जाके ये जो लोअर ग्रोथ आएगी तो उससे क्या होगा कि आपकी हाउस होल्ड एंड आपकी कॉर्पोरेट दोनों बैलेंस शीट काफी स्ट्रेस में आएगी और उसका डायरेक्ट इम्पैक्ट आपका फाइनेंशियल सेक्टर्स की हेल्थ के ऊपर होगा। तो आरबीआई के लिए ये जरूरी है कि कुछ भी करके फाइनेंशियल सेक्टर्स को किस तरह से बचा सके, बिकॉज किसी भी इकोनॉमी की लाइफलाइन होता है ये फाइनेंशियल सेक्टर्स। अगर वहां पे कुछ इश्यूज या डेंट लगता है तो फिर ग्रोथ को बाउंस बैक करना बहुत डिफिकल्ट हो जाएगा। हमें ये जो चैलेंजिंग टाइम है उसमें थोड़ा क्रिएटिव तरीके से सोचना होगा। क्या जैसे मैंने बोला कि अभी क्रूड का प्राइस $25 पर बैरल चल रहा है, तो हम अपना कुछ रिजर्व कर सके या नहीं कर सके? जैसे दो दिन पहले हमने देखा यूएस ने 75 मिलियन बैरल से $25 के आसपास उसने रिजर्व करके रख दिया, तो अगर हम लोग ऐसा कुछ रिजर्व कर सके। दूसरा, अभी जो ये ऑटो इंडस्ट्री में इश्यूज चल रहे हैं BS6 के, हम लोग अपनी सुप्रीम कोर्ट को रिक्वेस्ट करके वहां पे उसको कुछ रिलीफ दिला सके। थर्ड, सारी रियल एस्टेट कंपनी है, इंफ्रा कंपनी है, वहां पे उसको हम लोग कुछ थोड़ा एक्स्ट्रा FSI दिला के वहां पे उसको कुछ हम लोग बेनिफिट कर सके। आप आपका टेलीकॉम इंडस्ट्री देख लो, वहां पे ऑलरेडी AGR के इश्यूज चल रहे हैं, वहां पे आप उसको कुछ बेनिफिट दिला सको या नहीं दिला सको। तो अभी आपको ये देखना है, आप स्टिम्यूलस दे के, आप रेगुलेटरी फ्रंट पे, आप जुडिशरी फ्रंट पे, आप एडमिनिस्ट्रेटिव लेवल पे, आप कहाँ पे सपोर्ट करके ये सारी कंपनी को आप जिंदा रख सको। कोर्स हमारे लिए ह्यूमन के साथ साथ ये छोटे बिजनेस को भी सर्वाइव करना जरूरी है, ताकि आगे जाके ग्रोथ आएगी तब हम उसको बेनिफिट ले सकें।
Got a point. So you're trying to say that challenges will definitely be there, and because there will be challenges, opportunities will also be there. But only the time will only say that what kind of government pressures and what kind of actions that the task force will take that will drive the future economy of the India, and ultimately that will benefit the corporates and the business houses as well. Not your point. So question for you, Srikanth, that I believe that most of the private sector banks and PSUs have already started taking actions of what RBI directions has already been given to them. Just wanted to understand what the customer should do if their account is currently being managed by any tier 2 bank or cooperative bank or say NBFCs, according to you.
Okay. So I believe when you're talking about tier 2 banks, probably you are talking about banks like IndusInd Bank, Yes Bank,
correct,
IDFC First Bank, RBL Bank, to name a few. So Anand bhai, I can tell you one very important point that one thing is very clear, whether it's corona, not corona. Lending aggressively for these tier 2 banks was anyway very difficult. We had seen that in Yes Bank fiasco that common public do not have much trust on these tier 2 banks. People have waited on queue, people have so much inconvenience while taking their money out from Yes Bank. Therefore, these banks, along with the corona issues which everybody in the banking sector are facing, these banks will also face the discomfort, the distrust, I would say, mistrust from the public at large in terms of CASA deposits. Plus, as Sameer Bhai was telling, that their market capital also eroded heavily. We had seen that in IDFC case, you would be knowing that their certain stake. That was a different reason altogether, right? But yes, there was some kind of issue there also. Therefore, I strongly, if you are solely banking with these tier 2 banks, probably you should think about adding one more tier one bank, either from the private domain or from public domain, and go for a multiple banking arrangement. But this suggestion applies when you have a limit of more than 15, 20 crores. For a single limit below that, managing two banks are almost like managing two wives. So it's a not so easy task. When you're talking about cooperative banks, I believe cooperative banks, again, the situation remains the same. I don't think they have any liquidity issues as such. Yes, there was some issue of PMC, which we had seen in Mumbai. But the major issue with them would be that they have to curtail their limits to borrowers. They will not be in the position to offer you a bigger check. There are a clear-cut mandate from RBI to reduce the loan ticket size. Therefore, I have an opinion that if you are again banking with a cooperative bank, nothing wrong with it. Only thing is, for a larger ticket size, you need to plan it, because someday I was talking to a few of my customers and they were telling me that cooperative bank has already told them to reduce their exposure by certain percentage on year on year, because by 2025, they have to show some kind of commitment to RBI. So this is the situation for cooperative banks. When we are talking about NBFCs, for NBFCs, there are a couple of big NBFCs. I believe they have plus with funds. Their liquidity is definitely not a challenge. Plus, RBI has recently infused 50,000 crore through bankers to them. So they will definitely go aggressively, but as their nature, they will have a wait. And once market get open, they will come and give you money like anything, but they will not at all go aggressively until unless things become clear. So accordingly, you need to plan, because this is challenging time for banking also. People are trying to understand various stuff into very much uncertain time. So it's a difficult stuff. Therefore, you need to plan. You need to see what kind of policy the bank is finding it a little more difficult than it should be. You should plan for adding up one new bank company.
Got it. And currently, a lot of fear is currently going on amongst corporates, wherein their single question is that whether their credit rating is going to get affected. And if yes, then will it impact or affect their borrowing capacity as well? So what are your thoughts on it?
So, Anand bhai, I believe rating downgrade, I would rather say, is an inevitable. You would see that almost all the sectors, barring few which we just spoke, pharma, FMCG and all, barring these sectors, every sector got a big hit. There are companies, they are bigger companies, corporate companies, which are talking about additional credit lines for 30 to 60 days. As of now, we just seen 1 month of lockdown, and they started talking about 1 to 2 months of this additional credit facility. Therefore, I believe rating will certainly go down. However, I have one suggestion out here. If the rating is not mandated by your present bank, maybe ratings were due even if you are taking 5 crore loan from a PSU bank, but that limits have definitely increased. Therefore, if the rating is not mandated by your bank, you should rather defer it. Definitely, there would be ask from the credit rating agency for various data. They will follow up. But you should simply say that it's under process, because if you give data, your rating will come down. Your interest rate, plus there are a lot of stuff are related to your ratings. Because PSU, you would know that below investment grade and below certain grades, they find it very difficult. They do have their internal rating system, but it go hand in hand with the external rating system. So therefore, I would rather say to defer it if possible. Otherwise, if very much mandated, take a little time. But rating downgrade with one or two notch is definitely an inevitable.
Understood. And Surekanta, I mean, if this downgrade happens, and which is inevitable, as Srikanth rightly said, will it impact the interest rate and resulting into a increased rate of interest will get charged by the bank?
Yes, seeing that ratings for the corporates, the downgrades is imminent. But looking into the current situation, banks will make an exception and maintain status quo. At the same time, SEBI has also given some liberalization to rating agencies. But if default is there only due to this lockdown, they can consider it. Also, because the customer will have an existing relationship with the bank, and this past track record will also help him keep the prevailing rates. So this would help in the overall maintaining the current rates for the customer the bank.
And is there any other options available this moratorium period of 3 months? I mean, any other flexibility or any other measurements that has been announced by RBI and due by any public private sector banks?
Yes, we already know a lot about the moratorium, that it is not a waiver of, and it is for 3 months. But I've been getting a lot of questions from the clients that post the moratorium options. Basically, there will be three options post moratorium. One is that the 3 months interest you just pay off at one go. The EMI as per the contract we had signed at time of taking the loan. Second option will be that if customer wants to maintain the same EMI, he can add this interest to the loan amount and extend the tenure. So there's liquidity maintained and he'll not have effect on the cash flow. And the third option will be, if he's okay with the increase in EMI, he can keep the same tenure and pay off with the new loan amount by increasing the tenure. So basically these will be the three options.
Okay. And do you see any reduction in the interest rate going forward, as RBI has already reduced repo rate and reverse repo rate, and there's a lot of buzz going on that RBI, the bank will have to pass on that benefit to their end clients. So is there any possibilities in the near future?
Yeah, and looking into the current scenario, and with IMF already giving a forecast, Indian GDP at 1.9 and world GDP at -3, so RBI will not have any option but to increase consumption and to help the businesses. They'll have to lower rates, as we've seen in the last 2 months. And also in the next 1 year, we can see a reduction by 75 to 100 basis points. That's about 0.75 to 1% by March 21. At the same time, there will be a watch by the RBI on inflation, which Sameer Bhai has already said that the crude will be a factor which will help us. And also with a normal monsoon forecast will be an added advantage, which will help us to keep this inflation in check. And therefore, the rates will be on the lower side.
Okay. And as the asset quality of the bank would definitely get deteriorated to some extent, and it will have an impact on the capital adequacy ratio of the banks. As RBI has already given some stimulus package and made some liquidity inflow to the banks, do you see any this type of event one more time in near future of next, say, 6 to 12 months? Liquidity infusion by central bank?
We have seen the banks have reduced the repo rates as well as reverse repo rates. They've also increased the statutory liquidity and reduced the cash reserve requirements from the banks. At the same time, they have given us a moratorium. And also the real estate sector has been helped by helping them to enhance the date of commencement of operations, which can be delayed without it being a default. And also the long-term repo operations have been done with a new infusion of funds, liquidity raised of 2.5 lakh crores. So all this put together, there's about 4.25 lakh crores infused in the system.
Okay.
So we can expect more from RBI as well as the government. Looking in the world scenario, we can go a lot more further. But at the same time, RBI will have to nudge the banks to lend, because we have seen there is almost 7 lakh crores lying with the RBI, which the banks have parked and are lending. So right. There will be some support which will be required by the government or the RBI to help the banks lend and park the, some comfort for them.
Okay. Got it. So, Samir, some interesting facts I was reading about 3-4 days back, and that forced me to think about a question that is next to you. The fact was that around 15 to 16 billion foreign money was taken out from the Indian market, both, I mean, equity and debt, correct me if I'm wrong, in March, which made it the highest ever sell-off by any FIIs in this month. And this panic sell-off by FIIs led to massive liquidity outflow from domestic market, which resulted into the benchmark indices go down by more than 25% in March. According to you, should we sell off, liquidate our investment from the market, considering this FII trend, which we have been following since ages in India, saying that Indian market is currently being driven by FIIs only, and there is no depth in the market. Participants of the retail investor is very low. The moment FIIs take money out from the Indian market, everybody starts selling as far as the individuals and the corporates and their savings are concerned from the market. What are your honest reply for all of us?
So, Anand, the correct figure is $16.5 billion, not 15.
My God.
Out of 16.5, 8.5 from the equity and remaining 8 from the debt. But Anand, आपको ये समझना जरूरी है कि अभी जो पैसा निकल के कहाँ गया हुआ है? ये पैसा वहाँ पे जा रहा है जहाँ पे either interest rate zero है या फिर negative territory में है. Second, अगर आप देखो तो जिस country में भी वो पैसा जा रहा है, वो country का GDP it's lower than us. थर्ड एंड मोस्ट इम्पॉर्टेंट, वहां पे कोरोना पेशेंट केस हमसे काफी ज्यादा है. सो मैं आपको एक एग्जांपल देता हूं. अलोन यूएस ट्रेजरी बॉन्ड 100 trillion पैसा मैनेज कर रहा है एंड करंटली वहां पे इंटरेस्ट रेट जीरो है. जैसे ही सब कुछ थोड़ा बहुत सेटल डाउन होगा ना, वो पैसा वापस घूम के यहाँ पे इंडिया में आएगा. दूसरा एक मीथ है कि भाई एफआईआई पैसा बेच के जाती है तो मार्केट में डाउनफॉल आता है. मैंने यहाँ पे आपको कुछ फिगर शेयर किए हुए हैं. इफ यू लुक द फिगर ऑफ 2015, 2016, 2017, 2018, ईयर ऑन ईयर बेसिस पे एफआईआई ने सोल्ड किया हुआ है 18,000 करोड़, 12,000 करोड़, 43,000 करोड़, 74,000 करोड़. स्टिल ये चारों पांचों साल में इंडियन इक्विटी ने बहुत अच्छा परफॉर्मेंस किया हुआ है. वाई? जस्ट बिकॉज ऑफ डोमेस्टिक रिटेल एसआईपी कॉन्ट्रीब्यूशन. मैंने यहाँ पे आपको एक और फिगर शेयर किया हुआ है. इन 2016-17 मंथ ऑन मंथ जो एसआईपी से जो इन्वेस्टमेंट आता था रिटेल का, विच इज समवेयर 3,100 करोड़, एंड ईयरली बेसिस पे शायद 40-45,000 करोड़ का कॉन्ट्रीब्यूट करते थे, वो अभी 8,500 करोड़ मंथ ऑन मंथ एड कर रहे हैं. अगर आप सब कुछ सम अप करोगे तो इट रफली राउंड अबाउट 1 lakh crore. तो
एसआईपी
ओनली, एसआईपी ओनली रिटेल इन्वेस्टमेंट थ्रू एसआईपी 8,500 crore मंथली, 1 lakh crore ईयर ऑन ईयर बेसिस पे. सो नाउ वी आर नो लॉन्गर रिलाई ऑन द एफआईआई साइड. दूसरा, ऑलवेज वी फोकस ऑन द एफआईआई कि भाई एफआईआई क्या डेली बेच के जाता है, कितना बेच के निकल गया. बट जो एफआईआई का फंड्स आता है, जो इन्वेस्टमेंट्स आता है, उसमें काफी हेज फंड्स भी होते हैं जो शॉर्ट ड्यूरेशन के लेते होते हैं. आपको क्या फोकस करना है? एफडीआई अमाउंट. इन स्टार्टिंग यू सेड के लास्ट ईयर ऑलमोस्ट 6-6.5% इंडिया का ग्रोथ था, एंड वी आर अमंग द टॉप 10 जिसके पास सबसे ज्यादा एफडीआई आया. लुक एट द यस्टरडेज फिगर ओनली. फेसबुक हैड इन्वेस्टेड 5.7 बिलियन इन जियो. अभी आपका फॉरेक्स आप देखिए, $475 बिलियन का, विच इज वन ऑफ द हाइएस्ट. तो ये जो एफडीआई का पैसा आता है इंडिया में, वो बिजनेस में आता है, वो स्ट्रेटजी में आता है, एंड ये पैसा लॉन्ग टर्म रहता है, वो जल्दी निकलता नहीं है. तो रेश्योर रहिए, इंडिया में बहुत डेप्थ है, बहुत सारी अपॉर्चुनिटीज है, एंड आई फील कि आने वाले टाइम में इंडिया बहुत अच्छा ग्रो करेगी.
वंडरफुल, थैंक्स फॉर द क्लैरिफिकेशन समीर. सो Shrikant, my next question to you is that all of us know that MSMEs are likely to be severely impacted if this lockdown continues for a longer duration in the wake of this coronavirus epidemic. And I believe a large number of MSMEs could incur business losses. They would definitely face severe cash flow disruptions, and which will have an adverse impact on the livelihood of several people working in this sector. Considering this scenario and looking at the current market, whether any corporate should think about the takeover of a bank loan facility if there is a viable option to save on the interest rate, or should stay with the existing banker based on your experience?
Anand bhai, this particular question is very subjective actually. It really depends. It really depends on two most important things. The first important thing is, what is the difference? What is the difference what right now what you are paying and what is the proposed rate by new bankers? So that is one thing which you definitely need to consider. The second, more important I would rather say, is who is your existing bank? So as we had just spoken about tier 2 banks earlier, that tier 2 banks plus there are cooperative banks, their rates would always be a challenge. Right, and the challenge would grow further, because as we were talking that deposit, banks lend money majorly through CASA deposits, right? So we will find it very difficult for tier 2 banks to lend aggressively, as we discussed. Therefore, I would say if your banks are these tier 2 banks and the difference is more than 1%, you should definitely think to add one more bank. Whether fully take over, not take over, that really, really depends what kind of facility you are enjoying. If it's a 15-20 crores facility, you should think about a single bank. If more than that, you can think about adding one more bank, because takeover facility will also have their own charges. So therefore, I would suggest, depending on these two aspects, you should think about it. The second thing is, right now we would also see that, you know, there are banks who would behave in a very, very conservative basis. They would certainly see that they will keep on asking data. Their policy will not permit a kind of easy credit, I would say. So if you're finding challenge on that side, because you are genuine, there is some external effect of corona which has happened to you. So which has happened to overall, matlab it's rather bearing few industries, everybody is suffering that. So if you are getting pressure from their end, definitely then you should think about. And right now, tier one banks, either in the public domain or private domain, more preferred is the public domain, I would say, because they will have government pressure also to them to go easy on the credit side. So therefore, I would say, to answer your question, it really depends. And the bank with whom you are banking with, the difference between interest rate, after considering all these aspects, you should take your call.
But if, say, for example, I do have a facility with XYZ Bank and it is feasible. My past record is good, but my future, at least for next 12 to 18 months, the balance sheet may not be that much good. Even though that the PSU banks will consider this case for the takeover in this scenario?
Definitely, yes. See, this particular situation is not for a particular company, not for a particular industry, I would say. This has happened across countries, across nations. So therefore, bankers also understand that this particular situation, and they are even not expecting a wonderful balance sheet, right? Okay. I would rather say that if you are having a very beautiful balance sheet with all the numbers in place, you will find it difficult to get credit than not getting the credit. So
I agree.
So we should not worry about it, because this is not only for us. This is across industries, across company. Therefore, if your past track record is good, you have not defaulted on your loans, I don't think you should worry. You can definitely approach to any new banker who are aggressive in this market, who can support you much better than your existing bank.
Perfect. Got the point. So Samir, last question for you for today's session, and the most important and most interesting, and this correlates with my first poll question. Samir, do you think that the worst is over or still exists as the Sensex is near about 30,000? Samir, please unmute yourself.
Now audible?
Yeah.
Okay. So Anand, बहुत कुछ सिखाया है जिंदगी के सफर ने अनजाने में, वो किताबों में दर्ज था ही नहीं जो पढ़ाया सबक जमाने ने. लास्ट वन मंथ में हम कुछ ऐसी सिचुएशन से निकल रहे हैं. अगर आपने आनंद देखा होगा तो लास्ट वन वीक में मार्केट में काफी अच्छा पॉजिटिव रैली आया. आप यूएस मार्केट देखो तो ऑलमोस्ट 20% फ्रॉम द बॉटम वो वहां से बढ़ गया. इंडियन मार्केट 8,000 निफ्टी था, वो आपका बढ़ के 9,000 को क्रॉस कर गया. ऑलमोस्ट यहाँ पे भी हम लोग 13-14% रेस हुए. जो मार्केट में एक्सेस सेलिंग था, जो उसका ओवर रिएक्शन था, वो कहीं ना कहीं जाके अब सेटल डाउन हुआ ऐसा लग रहा है. आप पूछो मुझे कि समीर क्या लग रहा है अभी इन नियर टर्म, तो मुझे तीन प्रोबेबिलिटी लग रही है. सबसे वर्स्ट सिनेरियो क्या हो सकता है कि शायद थर्ड मे के बाद भी सब कुछ नॉर्मलाइज ना हो और जो केस है वो डे बाय डे बढ़ते ही रहे. तो ऑन दैट केसेस माइट बी मार्केट यहाँ से और नीचे जा सकता है. जैसे आपने स्टार्टिंग में पोल में लिखा था कि भाई माइट बी 8,000 को या 8,300 से नीचे भी हम लोग जा सकते हैं. यस, देयर इज अ पॉसिबिलिटी अगर 3-4 महीने और ये चला तो. दूसरा सबसे अच्छा सिनेरियो क्या है कि थर्ड मे में सब कुछ ओपन हो रहा है, नॉर्मलाइज हो रहा है, सारी इकोनॉमिक एक्टिविटी स्टार्ट हो रही है. ऑन दैट केसेस मार्केट में काफ़ी अच्छी अपॉर्चुनिटीज अभी अवेलेबल है, आपको डेफिनेटली यहाँ पे इन्वेस्टमेंट्स कर देना चाहिए. बट अगर आप मुझे पूछो तो मुझे सबसे जो रियलिस्टिक सिनेरियो ये लग रहा है कि थर्ड मे के बाद स्टेजेस वाइज धीरे धीरे करके सब कुछ ओपन होना स्टार्ट होगा एंड बाय जून एंड धीरे धीरे सिचुएशंस नॉर्मलाइज होगी. तो ऑन दैट केसेस फर्स्ट क्वार्टर आपका पूरा का पूरा वॉश आउट हो जाएगा. तो नियर टर्म में फिर मंडल के ऊपर वो न्यूज फ्लो के ऊपर ज्यादा रिएक्ट करेगा. अगर मार्केट में कहीं अच्छा न्यूज फ्लो आ जाता है ऑन द वैक्सीनेशंस को लेके कि भाई किसी ने वैक्सीन ढूंढ लिया या फिर आपका जो कर्व है वो फ्लैटर हो रहा है तो मार्केट डेफिनेटली ऊपर हो जाएगा. उस स्टिमुलस को लेके अभी 2 दिन से चल रहा है कि भाई गवर्नमेंट आर थिंकिंग ऑन द फिस्कल साइड, भाई वो वहां पे भी कुछ स्टिमुलस दे इंडिया में. तो अगर ऐसा भी कुछ पॉजिटिव न्यूज आता है तो मार्केट अगेन ऊपर हो जाएगा. बट ऑन नेक्स्ट 3-4 मंथ मार्केट बहुत वॉलेटाइल रहेगा. यहाँ से नीचे जाने का मुझे चांस नहीं दिख रहा है बहुत, एंड वी शेप रिकवरी भी नहीं दिख रही है. मैं आपको एक लास्ट में एक बात ये बताना चाहता हूँ कि ऑन द 1999 वी हैव सीन Y2K मूवमेंट. तब भी वायरस का कुछ इश्यू था, लोगों को लगा कि भाई 31 दिसंबर 1999 को कोई वायरस आ जाएगा एंड पूरी दुनिया के जितने भी कंप्यूटर है, सारी लैपटॉप है, सब कुछ बंद हो जाएंगे. इंडिया ने उसका कोई तरीका निकाल दिया एंड नेक्स्ट 10 ईयर्स में हम लोगों ने देखा हुआ है कि हम आज आईटी लेवल पे वर्ल्ड को डोमिनेट कर रहे हैं. तो करंटली मुझे ऐसा लग रहा है कि ऑन द हेल्थ केयर साइड एंड ऑन द मैन्युफैक्चरिंग साइड ये Y2K मूवमेंट है इंडिया के लिए, अपॉर्चुनिटी है. अगर हम उसको अच्छे से एनकेस कर पाए आगे तो आने वाले 10-15 ईयर्स इंडिया के लिए बहुत ही ग्लोरियस रहेंगे. या थैंक यू.
Perfect. Thanks a lot, Samir bhai. So I'm done with my questions, but there are a few questions that participants has raised, and I would request panelists to just give your honest feedback about the same. So there is a question from Hardeep that how do you see new NPAs of the bank and how much time it would take for banks to come out? Srikant and Srikant bhai, how do you see new NPAs of the bank and how much time it would take for banks to come out?
Anand bhai, I believe, see, as far as NPAs are concerned, I believe there are lot of sectors which are facing lot many problems. So even government is very clear about it. Bankers at top level are very concerned about it. So giving you answer about it, that how much NPA percentage will rise, this all will depend actually on the fiscal stimulus which the government is going to give. whatever government has given till now, that is not sufficient. Let me be honest with you. That is not sufficient. That your business has shut down. You need to pay wages. You need to pay rents. You need to pay interest also. So, and you are not earning, right? And the irony is that before Corona also, there were certain sectors which were not doing great. If you talk about auto sector, they were not doing great also before Corona. So therefore, government and banks at a senior level are thinking what to do, because not that everybody is having a wrong intention to default. And mass NPA rise will not even benefit the country. Right now, I would say we should wait for some time, what government stimulus will come, what kind of packages they are offering, because we had seen various developed nations had given lot of packages to corporates for their wages also, for their interest rate also. So for that, we just need to wait for our country also. I believe they are working on it. I don't think we need to wait longer. Maybe in a week's time, a maximum 10 days, we would hear from our RBI about lot of clarity. Post that, I believe we would be in situation to tell you what NPA could rise in this country.
Okay. And so whether banks are able to tolerate the burden of these NPAs, and will we be seeing any consolidation into the banking system, as we have seen in past last few years?
See, if you see consolidation up, or now very few, because whatever consolidation was about to happen, that already been done. We are now left with banks, and there are few one more which are left. So probably there we can think about the consolidation. But right now, I don't think government or RBI is thinking about consolidation part as of now.
Okay.
What I can tell you that, yes, see, the NPA that there are what is NPA? If we want to consider as a layman language, what is NPA? If you don't pay your interest or your principal payment for 90 days, then it becomes NPA, right? Earlier, NBFCs were following 180 days policy because RBI was given them those permission. Even some days back, some years back, they were following 365 days also. So probably RBI must be thinking that even if they extend this NPA norms, maybe 150, 180 days, then you save lot of NPAs. Right. So there are various stuff because even RBI or government doesn't want that NPA to increase, because it will not help corporates to raise funds. It will not help in terms of employment. Therefore, I would rather say that I am not that worried that NPA will rise significantly. There would policy which would come, which will help corporates to serve their interest, which would help bankers to avoid NPAs. Maybe the corporates are facing problems, but there would be some provisions which would certainly help corporates in that segment.
Okay. And Samir, there's a question for you with last 2 months of disruption that has caused massive problems, do you believe that our foundation could be very weak, and that's the reason this disruption or this massive problems scenario is happening? Or thereby meaning that there are very few valuable companies in the country from an investment perspective? Samir? Unmute yours.
And can you repeat, because starting mein disturbance aa
raha hai. Yeah. I'm saying that with 2 months of disruption that has caused such a massive problem, right, do you feel that our foundation was weak and that could be one reason? And also that there are very few valuable companies in the country. So from an investment perspective also, how would you see this situation?
So Anand, main aap ko ek bahut clear aapko answer de raha hu ki आप टॉप कंपनी को छोड़ दीजिए, तो मैक्सिमम कंपनी यहाँ पे वो लोगों ने डेट रेस किया हुआ है, फंड रेसिंग करके वो बिजनेस कर रहे हैं, वहाँ पे बहुत चैलेंजेस हैं। चैलेंजेस दो जगह पे, एक जो वर्कर्स थे जो माइग्रेट होके आए थे वो वापस चले गए हैं, कितने लोग वापस आएंगे, कैसे वापस आएंगे, नॉर्मलाइज कैसे सब कुछ स्टार्ट होगा, इट्स रियली वरीड। तो सप्लाई चेन था, सप्लाई चेन पूरा का पूरा वो ब्रेक हो गया है। काफ़ी छोटे मोटे जो वेंडर्स होते हैं जिसके पास से रॉ मटेरियल आता है, वो दे आर ऑल्सो इट इज फेसिंग लॉट्स ऑफ चैलेंजेस। अगर उसके पास पैसा नहीं है, वो रॉ मटेरियल बना नहीं पाएंगे, तो वो पूरा सप्लाई एटलीस्ट आगे तक नहीं आ रहा है। तो यहाँ पे दो पार्ट में चैलेंजेस चल रही है। गवर्नमेंट जब तक स्टिमुलस या फिर स्पेसिफिकली इंडस्ट्री को कोई एक्स्ट्रा इन टर्म्स ऑफ मॉनिटरी बेनिफिट नहीं देगी, तो मुझे लग रहा है कि भाई आगे आने वाला चैलेंजेस बहुत डिफिकल्ट होने वाला है। मैं काफ़ी कॉर्पोरेट्स के साथ अभी छोटी मोटी कॉर्पोरेट्स के साथ मेरी बातचीत चलती रहती है, एंड दे आर रियली वरीड कि समीर कब खोलेंगे, कैसे खोलेंगे। अभी गवर्नमेंट ने बोल तो दिया हुआ है कि पेमेंट्स करना है, पैसा देना है, सैलरी देना है, कहाँ से मैं पैसा दूँ। सी वी नीड टू अंडरस्टैंड, ये जो कॉर्पोरेट्स होती है या फिर ये जो एंटरप्रेन्योर होते हैं, वो एनजीओ नहीं है। दे लुक्स इकोनॉमिक्स, उसको लगेगा 2 महीना 3 महीना, तो तीसरे महीने वो बंद कर देंगे सब कुछ। तो अगर गवर्नमेंट के यहाँ से कुछ अगर स्टिमुलस या कुछ पैकेजेस नहीं आ रहे हैं, जो टैक्स पेयर है उसके पास पैसा नहीं आ रहा है, तो कुछ नहीं होने वाला है। जैसे सूर्यकांत भाई ने बोला कि भाई इंटरेस्ट रेट डाउन नीचे जाएंगे, मैं आपको एग्जांपल दे रहा हूँ कि रोल्स रॉयल्स आपको 0% पे मिल रही है, आप लोगे क्या? कुछ पेमेंट करने के लिए मेरे पास पैसा तो चाहिए ना। तो जब तक मेरे हाथ में, मेरे पॉकेट में पैसा नहीं आएगा, तब तक तो कुछ होने वाला नहीं है। तो यस, आपको नेक्स्ट 3 महीने 4 महीने देखना है कि कौन सा बिजनेस सर्वाइव हो पा रहा है, कहाँ पे चैलेंजेस है, एंड जहाँ पे डेट है, जहाँ पे कंसर्न्स है, आप उनसे जीत उतने आपके पर्सनल इन्वेस्टमेंट एंड पर्सनल अच्छा रहेगा।
ओके ओके, तो वंस अगेन क्वेश्चन फॉर यू एंड श्रीकांत बोथ, highly capital intensive industry, so from investment standpoint and from debt standpoint, according to both of you, Shrikant and Samir, what will be the future of textile in India? Because there are few participants from this particular field, so they have raised this question just for their industry perspective.
Anand bhai, as far as lending is concerned in textile industry, I would rather say textile will find it very difficult to raise funds for their expansion plans. So whether you talk about weaving, whether you talk about ginning, whether you talk about any fabric or whatever, they will find it very difficult if they are going for any expansion plan, or even if they have ordered some machineries and they want to pay for those machineries and all. However, I believe there is a significant exposure right now which bankers have on the textile industry. So therefore, maintaining those exposures, providing them working capital facilities, because all said and done, this particular industry has survived and has given lot many job opportunities in the past. Therefore, there would see, still we had not seen industry-wise package from the government. Textile in past also, there are various incentives, various packages had been offered by government in terms of interest rate benefits, interest of capital benefits. So there are so many benefits had already been provided. Industry package would come. Textile would be one sector where government would certainly give more packages to them for florists, because this is a sector which give lot of job opportunities. Therefore, I'm hopeful for it. But for next 6 to 12 months, yes, they will not be find it easy to go for any expansion plan.
Anand, मैं यहाँ पे दो चीज और ऐड करना चाहता हूँ। Textile industry, Anand, तो textile industry mainly export काफी कुछ करती है, तो ऐसा मैंने पहले ही बोला हुआ है कि मुझे नहीं लग रहा है कि नियर टर्म एक्सपोर्ट को लेके कुछ इतना एनकरेजमेंट रहेगा। जहाँ जो कंट्री में आप एक्सपोर्ट कर रहे हो, वहाँ पे इतने सारे चैलेंजेस है, वहाँ पे इतने सारे इश्यूज है, तो वहाँ से ऑर्डर आना, यहाँ से वहाँ पे गुड्स को डिलीवर करना, ट्रांसपोर्टेशन करना, ये बहुत बड़ी डिफिकल्टीज एंड चैलेंजेस रहने वाली है। दूसरा, डोमेस्टिक कंजम्पशन, तो वहाँ पे भी मुझे लग रहा है कि जो लाइफस्टाइल था या जो कुछ भी हम लोग जहाँ पे भी स्पेंडिंग कर रहे थे, आज मेरे पॉकेट में पैसा नहीं है। सी, मेरा जॉब ही नहीं रहा है, मेरे पास पैसा ही नहीं, मैं कहाँ पे स्पेंड करूँगा? तो दिस आर द टू सिनेरियो, मुझे लग रहा है कि डेफिनेटली and lifestyle and woh sare mein at least kafi kuch issues aane wale
hain. And Anand bhai, this the third very important thing is this particular industry is a leveraged industry. So
highly leveraged
industry hai. Therefore ye is tarike ke risk के लिए बहुत इस तरह के जो भी शॉक्स लगते हैं कंट्री को उसके लिए एनी विच वे दीज इंडस्ट्रीज आर वेरी मच वल्नरेबल. सो देयरफॉर एज आई हैव टोल्ड दैट 6 to 12 मंथ्स वुड डेफिनेटली बी अ डिफिकल्ट टाइम फॉर दिस इंडस्ट्री.
राइट. श्रीकांत भाई, टू क्वेश्चंस फॉर यू. आई मीन यू वुड हैव वर्कड विद वेरियस एमएसएमईज इन पास्ट थ्रू आउट योर 25 प्लस इयर्स ऑफ करियर. व्हाट इज योर जेन्युइन एडवाइस टू एमएसएमईज व्हिच कैरीज debt on their balance sheet in this tough time where businesses will get slowed down, cash flow problems will definitely be there, and there is a question for a growth also, and entrepreneurs are trying their hard to manage all of things. So what is a genuine advice being a banker to MSME?
For the MSME sector, definitely, again, as we have already discussed, there will be some packages for them. There will be some handholding. At the same time, they will also have to go for some harsh measures, some cost controls, which will help them to maybe bring mission or some change in their working, more technology. Or so that way, they will have to survive for a time being. And of course, there will be some handholding from the government as well as the bankers for them. Those who have had a good relation, who have had a good business, I think they will survive and they will be helped by these institutions.
Shikant, would you like to say something on this?
See, it was very well said by Shrikant bhai that definitely MSME segment, they have to definitely think about curtailing some cost. Plus, in terms of financing, then as I have told that there would be certain options like which are not collateral backed, which is like bill discounting facility, supply chain finance.
Yeah,
if they are supplying to major corporates, they should think about some kind of innovative solutions. So while on working side, they should think about supply chain. While capex side, they should think about leasing solutions, which are not loans to their books, renting options of machineries, reducing some take home, reducing the entrepreneurs must think to reduce their own consumption for the time being, because everybody is going through a difficult phase. So these are certain, because opportunity will definitely come if companies from China, companies from Japan and other developed nations are coming to country. There would be opportunities, but for that we should be prepared. We should be at least survive first. I would rather say we should survive first in this difficult time. Once we survive, we will have those opportunity to grab with both of our hands.
Correct. So last question for you, Shrikant. Somebody wanted to know that how much spread bank can keep to lend. Suppose today repo rate is 4.8% and bank lend us at 9% on CC limit. People are not getting any benefit of reduced interest rate. I think we have covered this point in the Q&A session, but how would you elaborate this? How much spread bank can keep?
See, Anand bhai, we need to understand that banks are not only dependent on repo rate. It's not the major source of their funds to lend into the market. They majorly dependent on the CASA deposits. You would have seen that these days the FDs rate is roaming around 5.5 to 7% depending on banks to bank. Therefore, I would rather say that at present the average rate which bankers are paying to the market would be about 6%. Then there is 1% of the administration cost which they need to think about it. They need to add on whatever the borrowing cost they have. And then there are NPAs also. Then there are other costs also. So I believe the rates would move down because government is very clear. The RBI is very clear, in fact, to reduce the rates because this is a difficult time. But repo rate will not be a key factor to decide. In fact, reverse repo, I would say, is more important than repo because whatever happens, certain times that bankers deposit their money into RBI and get some kind of interest rate, which is called reverse repo. So RBI is knowingly reducing that rate of interest so that banks can lend it to the market. So I would rather say I'm looking interest rate in the range of 8 to 8.5% in a very near future. Below that, yes, there are subsidies. If governments are willing to give subsidies, then banks can offer. Otherwise, right now, it looks difficult to go below 8%.
Perfect. Mm-hmm. Thanks for the input, Srikanth. So now we are coming to an end to this session. It's almost 1.5 hour, the time that we have taken. At the end, I would like to thank Srikanth, Srikanth, Samir for your valuable time. Would also like to thank all the parties. We will do a similar session after a month or 1.5 months from now, considering that time's situation on that time's issue topics relevant to the investment and banking industry. But till that time, I will definitely share the contact details of all the panelists. I would request Samir to at least pass on the details to all the participants over here. And that's it for today. Once again, thanks a lot, and please do visit Be Hunger Hero platform and do try and contribute as this live panel discussion was conducted with a specific course to help this particular initiative. Thanks a lot once again, and stay safe at home. Bye bye. See you.
Thank you.